All right. Thanks, Carl, and thanks to everyone for being here. I think I should be fine with the lighting. There's a grandmother poem for tonight, so just for you.
Thank you.
Much like Leslie, the family seems to be an endless wellspring for me of inspiration. Either that or I'm still trying to get even and exact revenge, but I can't get away from them. So this third book, well, let me explain a little bit more about where that comes from. In part, I also, as Leslie, you had that term of my imaginary world or the world of my imagination. And I grew up in not only one imaginary world, but two. And that was growing up in Miami. One was America. The Miami I grew up in was a very culturally isolated, basically everyone was Cuban, the neighbor was Cuban, the grocery store guy was Cuban, the classmates were Cuban. So America was kind of like this other place that we hadn't been to yet. And the other imaginary place was the 1950s and 60s of Cuba, which were in all the stories of my parents and grandparents, another place that I could only go through in my imagination. So that has, for obvious reasons, my family has continued to obsess me and their tales and their stories. Throughout the different books, those things kind of evolve in different ways, but still in this book, a lot of that is in there. One particular memory I have that I was always wanted to write about was the Miss America pageant, which in our house was a very big deal for some God unknown reason, which is kind of like why I wanted to write this poem. But it's also my secret wish to be American, finally. So it's like always teetering on, like, could it be that my parents, could we be one or the other for once, please? So anyway, here we go. It's somewhat of a humorous look, which you can't help when you're talking about a Cuban family. It's called Betting on America. My grandmother was the bookie. Yep, set up at the kitchen table that night, her hair in curlers, pencil and pad, jotting down $2 bets, paying 5-1 on which Miss would take the crown. Abuelo put his money on Miss Wyoming. She's got great teeth, he pronounced, as if complimenting a horse, not her smile, filling in the camera before she whisked away like a cloud in her creamy chiffon dress. I dug up enough change from the sofa and car seats to bet on Miss Wisconsin, thinking I was as American as she because I was as blonde as she was, and I knew that's where all the cheese came from. That wasn't all. Chocolate was from Miss Pennsylvania. The capital of Miss Montana was Helena. Mount Rushmore was in Miss South Dakota, and I knew how to say Connecticut. Unlike my tia Gloria, who just pointed at the TV, esa, esa, that one, claiming she had her same figure before leaving Cuba. It's true, I have pictures, she declared, before cramming another bocadito sandwich into her mouth. Papa refused to bet on any of the misses because Americas ain't got no ass, he complained. There's nothing like a big culo cubano. Everyone agreed, es verdad, except for me and my little cousin Julito, who apparently was a breast man at age 5, reaching for Miss Alabama's breasts on the screen. The lady mulata sashaying in pumps, swimsuit, seducing Tio Pedro into picking her as the sure winner. She's the one. She looks cubana, he swore. And she did, but she cost him $5. Cojone, he complained as confetti rained, Burt Parks leading Miss Ohio, the new Miss America, by the hand to the runway. Gloves up to her elbows, velvet down to her feet, crying diamonds into her bouquet, the queen of our country, our land of the free, amid the purple mountains of Her Majesty, floating across the stage, our living room. Though no one bet on her, and none of us, not even me, could answer Mama when she asked, ¿Dónde está Ohio? I see the movie thing now. It's happening. Now that you mentioned it.
They're wonderful.
I need a few more relatives to pass away now. I'm lucky enough that my mother still lives in the house that I pretty much grew up in. And this is sometimes a source of confusion for actually some of my Florida friends that are here. Wait, does anybody know what a Florida room is? And some people, you say that and they're like, it's a Florida. It's basically like a, it's not quite a spring porch. It's kind of a den, but not really. It's kind of a family room. But in Florida, it's called a Florida room. And anyway, it reminds me of this quote by Pascal that I'm haunted by. It's somewhat, I'm paraphrasing. The sole cause of a man's unhappiness is his inability to stay quietly in his room. And for me, that room in that house is the Florida room, which was sort of the center. And every time I go back, that is home. El Florida room. Not a study or a den, but El Florida, as my mother called it. A pretty name for the room with the prettiest view or the lipstick red hibiscus puckered up against the windows. The tepid breeze laden with the brown sugar scent of loquats drifting in from the yard. Not a sunroom, but where the sun both rose and set. All day the shadows of banana trees fan dancing across the floor. And if it rained the loudest, like marbles clunking across the roof under constant threat of coconuts ready to fall from the sky. Not a sitting room, but El Florida, where I sat alone for hours with butterflies frozen on the polyester curtains and faces of Yadro figurines, sad angels, clowns, and princesses with eyes glazed blue and gray, gazing from behind the glass doors of the wall cabinet. Not a TV room, but where I watched Creature Feature as a boy, clinging to my brother, safe from vampires, in the same sofa where I fell in love with Clint Eastwood and my abuelo watching westerns, or pitying women crying in telenovelas with my abuela. Not a family room, but the room where my father twirled his hair while listening to 8 tracks of Elvis, read Nietzsche and Kant a few days before he died, where my mother learned to dance alone as she swept, and I learned salsa pressed against my tia Julia's enormous breasts. At the edge of the city, in the company of crickets, beside the empty clothesline, telephone wires, and the moon, tonight, my life is an old friend sitting with me. Not in the living room, but in the light of El Florida, as quiet and necessary as any of the stars shining above it. One of the things that's new for me in this particular book that I became interested in is in the intersection of my sexuality with my cultural identity. And so my grandmother was Paul. Okay, we're going to have to hold that one. We'll have to hold that one for a minute. Okay. Let me go back to another relative. One of the things that's also new for this book, actually, is that since I wrote my first book 12 years ago, is that I've had to witness the passing away of many of the older generation, which, of course, also makes you question your own mortality now that I'm not quite that young anymore. But I wanted a way of sort of just capturing them. They're not quite elegies, but a way of memorializing them, portraits of them that became important for posterity to have them somewhere. And one of these is my tia Jucha in this one. It is getting done. Unspoken elegy for tia Jucha. I arrive with a box of guava pastelitos, a dozen red carnations, and a handful of memories at her door. The half moons of her French manicure, how she spoke blowing out smoke, cigarette smoke, her words leaving her mouth as ghosts, the music of her nicknames, Jucha, Juchita, Jucha, Juchita. I kiss her hello, and she slaps me hard against my arm. Cabrón, too handsome to visit your tía, eh? She laughs, pulls me inside her efficiency. A place I thought I had forgotten comes back to life with wafts of Jean Maté and pine salt. The same calendar from Marcia León with scenes of old Havana on the wall. The same peppermint in a crystal dish. And her, wearing a papery housecoat, sneakers with pantyhose, like she wore those summer mornings she'd walk me down to the beach along First Street, past the washed-up pinks and blues of the Art Deco hotels, like old toys. The retirees lined across the verandas like seagulls peering into the horizon, the mango popsicles from the bodeguita, and the pier she told me was once a bridge to Cuba, have all vanished. I ask how she's feeling, but we agree not to talk about that today. Though we both know why I have come to see her. In a few months, maybe weeks, her lungs will fill up again. Her heart will stop for good. She too will vanish, except what I remember of her and this afternoon. Sharing a pastelito over a cafe she sweetens with people now. At her dining table, crowded with boxes of low-salt saltines and fibery cereals. Under the watch of Holy Jesus' heart burning on the wall, we gossip about the secret crush she had on my father once. She counts exactly how many years and months since she left Cuba and her mother forever. We complain about the wars, disease, fires blazing on the midday news as she dunks the flowers in a tumbler. A dozen red suns burst in the sapphire sky, framed in the window, sitting by the table. Okay, pause that. let's see if it'll work.
Sorry about the no line.
Farsighted or nearsighted, which are
very good.
It kind of half memorized. So, before Paul, what I was trying to say is, what's interesting to me in this book is sort of how cultural identity and sexual identity cross, and the figure of that a lot is my grandmother. So, my grandmother was both homophobic and xenophobic. So, an interesting combination, because not only was queer stuff queer, but anything that was foreign was also sort of perceived as queer. So, things like Legos were queer, as we say in the poem. And I was like, I mean, beyond, not because it was strange, it was just, it was gay. So, this is one of my lasting tributes to her. And so, it's called Queer Theory According to My Grandmother. And, of course, this is in her voice. Sure, I can read this again. Never drink soda with a straw. Milkshakes? Maybe. Stop buying your mother's Avon catalog and the men's underwear in those Sears flyers. I've seen you. Stay out of her Tupperware parties and perfume bottles. Don't let her kiss you. She kisses you much too much. Avoid hugging men, but if you must, pat them real hard on the back, even if it's your father. Must you keep that cat? Don't pet him so much. Why don't you like dogs? Never play house, even if you're the husband. Quit hanging out with that Henry kid. He's too pale, and I don't care what you call them. Those G.I. Joes of his are dolls. Don't draw rainbows or flowers or sunsets. I've seen you. Don't draw at all. No coloring books either. Put away your crayons, your Play-Doh, your Legos. Where are your Hot Wheels, your laser gun and handcuffs, the knives I gave you? Never fly a kite or roller skate, but light all the firecrackers you want. Kill all the lizards you can. Cut up worms. Feed them to that cat of yours. Those fancy books on architecture and art, I threw them in the trash. You can't wear cologne or puka shells, and I better not catch you in clogs. If I see you in a ponytail, I'll cut it off. What? No, you can't pierce your ear, left or right side. I don't care. You will not look like a goddamn queer. I've seen you, even if you are one. And I'll just close with what's the title poem of this last collection, which kind of started the whole book. Looking for the Gulf Motel, a short story about that. This place on the West Coast in Marco Island, where I took my partner Mark, wanting to show him Marco Island as I remembered it. And as any of you who frequent Miami or South Florida a lot, you know, it changes every 5 minutes. So what I found myself was in a peculiarly interesting position where I was being nostalgic and just a real grouch, in the same way that my parents were always nostalgic about Cuba and complaining how, you know, things have changed and everything they lost and all this stuff. So I find myself sort of thinking of that Elizabeth Bishop line, says, I've lost two cities, lovely ones. So I've lost two worlds in some way. Looking for the Gulf Motel. There should be nothing here. I don't remember. The Gulf Motel with mermaid lampposts and ship's wheel in the lobby should still be rising out of the sand like a cake decoration. My brother and I should still be pretending we don't know our parents, embarrassing us as they roll a luggage cart past the front desk, loaded with our scruffy suitcases, 2 dozen loaves of Cuban bread, brown bags bulging with enough mangoes to last a week, our espresso pot, the pressure cooker, and a pork roast reeking garlic through the lobby. All because we can't afford to eat out, not even on vacation. Only 2 hours from our home in Miami, but far enough away to be thrilled by the whiter sands on the west coast of Florida, where I should still be for the first time watching the sun set instead of rise over the ocean. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My mother should still be in the kitchenette of the Gulf Motel, her daisy sandals from Kmart squeaking across the linoleum, still gorgeous in her teal swimsuit and amber earrings, stirring a pot of arroz con pollo, adding sprinkles of onion powder and dollops of tomato sauce. My father should still be in a terry cloth jacket, smoking, clinking a glass of amber whiskey in the sunset at the Gulf Motel, watching us dive into the pool, 2 boys he'll never see grow into men who will be proud of him. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My brother and I should still be playing Parcheesi. My father should still be alive, slow dancing with my mother on the sliding glass balcony of the Gulf Motel. No music, only the waves keeping time, a song only their minds hear 10,000 nights back to their life in Cuba. My mother's face should still be resting against his bare chest, like the moon resting on the sea. The stars should still be turning around them. There should be nothing here I don't remember. My brother should still be 13, sneaking rum in the bathroom, sculpting naked women from sand. I should still be 8 years old, dazzled by seashells and how many seconds I can hold my breath underwater, but I'm not. I'm 38, driving up Collier Boulevard, looking for the Gulf Motel, for everything that should still be but isn't. I want to blame the condos, their shadows for ruining the beach and my past. I want to chase the snowbirds away with their tacky McMansions and yachts. I want to turn the golf courses back into mangroves. I want to find the Gulf Motel exactly as it was and pretend for a moment nothing lost is lost. Thank you.